Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions. The portfolio on this occasion is social justice. Members wishing to ask a supplementary question should press the request to speak buttons during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it's doing to promote the uptake of the Scottish Child Payment.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley Ann-Simon.
Our game-changing Scottish Child Payment is putting money into the pockets of the families of more than 327,000 children, with £573 million paid since launch. We're also encouraged to see our latest estimates of take-up rates of all children under age 16 at the end of March 2023 is 83%. However, we know there is always more we can do. Social Security Scotland continuously promotes the Scottish Child Payment across multiple channels, including social media, marketing, news releases and via key stakeholders, to the distribution of promotional materials to partners, including libraries, nurseries and schools.
Marie McNair.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Can the Cabinet Secretary comment on the impact it's having on keeping children in Scotland out of poverty? And does she share my concerns about the Westminster Government's two-child policy and its undermining efforts? And will she be clear that the two-child poverty with its abhorrent rape clause will never be considered for the Scottish Child Payment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I can, of course, confirm to the member that the Scottish Child Payment is available for every eligible child. Modelling suggests that the Scottish Government policies will keep 100,000 children out of relative poverty in 24-25, and that includes keeping 60,000 children out of poverty through the Scottish Child Payment. The UK Government, the member is quite right, could do so much more. They could lift a further 40,000 children out of poverty next year if they made key changes to Social Security, including reversing that two-child limit and introducing an essentials guarantee. It is disappointing, Presiding Officer, that the spring budget actually held none of those policies, and therefore those children will remain in poverty due to the Westminster's inactivity.
Question 2, Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to bring empty properties back into use for housing.
Minister Paul McLennan.
We continue to tackle empty homes as a priority, bringing more homes back to use as warm, safe and secure housing. Our interventions have been recognised by an independent audit, which endorses the £3.2 million investment in the Scottish Empty Homes Partnership that has seen over 9,000 private loaned homes successfully returned to use. That's why I was pleased yesterday to announce a further £423,000 of funding to support this important work in 24-25. Mr Briggs is also aware that I wrote to Parliament in September to outline the further actions we are taking to enhance our approach, which reflects the wide range and complexity of circumstances that have to be addressed.
Miles Briggs.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and I agree we need to see a real call to action to bring the estimated 43,000 empty homes back into use in Scotland. Shelter have done some really welcome work in England to support councils to do that. Can I ask the Minister, here in Edinburgh, for example, in my own council area, there are 3,000 council-owned empty properties. What work will the Government do to help councils to fund these projects, to bring them back? And have the Scottish Government looked at an empty homes refurbishment fund, for example, to help councils to bid for money to bring these properties back into use?
Minister.
Yeah, referring back to the Edinburgh situation, I met Edinburgh just last week when we were talking about void, which are a number, and I think we've had that discussion, and empty homes and what we can do specifically around about that. So we've asked Edinburgh for proposals specifically on that to see how we can work with them. And again, it comes back to, you know, I mentioned the further £423,000 of funding to support this important work, as I said, ongoing this year. But happy to continue to discuss this with the member going forward.
Supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In much of rural and island Scotland, derelict and empty properties litter the landscape. Does the Minister agree that bringing such properties back into habitation is both vital to reinvigorate communities and, in most instances, considerably less expensive than new-build housing? What progress has been made over the last year and will be in the next year in delivering on that objective?
Minister.
I thank the member for his question. I've been engaging closely with local authorities, housing providers and businesses in rural areas to support delivery of more affordable homes across rural and island areas, as well as how best use of our existing supplier. Rural and Islands Housing Action Plan supports the delivery of the Scottish Government's commitment to deliver 110,000 affordable homes, of which 10% will be in rural and island areas. The plan recognises that alongside delivery of new homes for rural and island communities, existing homes is a key part of our approach, including bringing empty homes back into active use.
Question 3, Ross McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has undertaken regarding the incorporation of the definition of deafblindness into the work of Social Security Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Social Security Scotland works with individuals and disability organisations to design services, and every stage of the application process has been tested. The initial equality impact assessment for communication support for deaf, deafblind and hard of hearing Social Security Scotland clients was completed in May 2022. People can apply in ways that suit them best, either by phone, online or paper application form, and local delivery advisers offer in-person support in every local authority area. We are committed to continually improving our delivery of benefits, and the people of Scotland can be assured that that will be based on dignity, fairness and respect.
Ros McCall.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The cross-party group on deafness, of which I'm Deputy Convener, has worked tirelessly towards a definition of deafblindness being adopted in Scotland. It's the Nordic model. It's been accepted in the UK since 1995 and the recognised definition across the EU, which the Scottish Government has frequently stated they wish to align. My question is simple, Cabinet Secretary. Will the Scottish Government reassess its position not to recognise the definition of deafblindness so that people across Scotland are clear on what they may or may not be eligible for?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I appreciate that there is an ongoing campaign on the formal definition of deafblindness, and appreciate there was indeed a member's business on this matter most recently. I'm happy to, of course, hear from Ros McCall in greater detail on this issue, as I'm sure our colleagues in Social Security Scotland. And while the campaign may be ongoing on this, it is important that we continue the dialogue, continue our discussions to make sure that we are supporting every client that comes to Social Security Scotland. And as I say, I'm happy to carry on that dialogue, as I'm sure are the agency.
Question 4 is not lodged. Question 5, Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to reduce social housing waiting lists for disabled people.
Minister Paul McLennan.
The Scottish Government has led the UK in housing by delivering more than 126,000 affordable homes since 2007, over 89,000 of which were for social rent, including almost 24,000 council homes. We will also invest £556 million in affordable housing in 2024-25. The majority of which will be for social rent. We remain focused on delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, and to support that, we'll bring forward a review scheduled for 2026-27 to 2024, which will concentrate on deliverability. We're also working with the financial community in Scotland and elsewhere to boost private sector investment and help deliver more homes. I think there's also a role for local authorities in preparing their local housing strategies. So these are discussions I have with local authorities in terms of that. One, to identify what the waiting lists are, and two, the actions that they're undertaking in that regard.
Megan Gallagher.
The Minister might be aware that in North Lanarkshire, 1,170 disabled people are currently stuck in social housing waiting lists, many of which are children. Instead of taking this issue seriously, the SNP Government has chosen to slash the housing budget by over £200 million in the past year. Therefore, I ask the Minister, how does he expect to cut down these lists when social house building is being discouraged by his own government's cuts?
Minister.
I'll come on to that point in a little second. I think one of the key things I want to mention was about the launch of consultation on housing for varying needs in June this year, and that closed in December. And of course, that's in new builds. I think when we come to talk around about investment in social housing, there are a couple of points of context. One, we build 40% more homes, affordable homes, than England, 70% more than Wales. There's a 10% capital budget cut, 10% capital budget cut from your government. Now, 10% capital budget cut from your government, which obviously you have no influence on whatsoever. The biggest cut in terms of that, and there's a choice of the Tory government to cut the capital budget to ourselves. There's a 62%...
Minister, can you resume your seat?
My apologies.
It started with the question, which was getting heckled, disappointingly, by some who'd already been invited to ask a question. The answers are now being heckled likewise. We're not going to get through this if this continues. Minister, please continue.
Yeah, I mentioned about the 10% capital budget cut. There's also the dramatic cut in financial transactions, which gave us flexibility around about that. We also spend £90 million a year on discretionary housing payment, again due to policies by your government. Now, if they removed these, we'd have £90 million extra to invest in houses that you're talking about.
Through the chair, please, Minister. A couple of supplementaries. First, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister will be aware of the Dying in the Margins work by Marie Curie and the University of Glasgow, which has again reinforced the significant demand for adapted properties for people who are diagnosed with a terminal illness. Not only this, but the impact that when someone passes has on their family when they have to move out of an adapted property very quickly. So can the Minister say what work the Government is going to do to engage with this piece of work to ensure that sufficiency of adapted properties and that support for people who are grieving?
Minister.
It's actually, and thank the member for his question, it's actually good timing. I actually spoke to Ellie Wagstaff at an event last night and she talked about this particular project, and I think we both attended it. I'd also been doing a piece of work with MND, and these are people in similar positions, obviously, with debilitating diseases or terminal diseases. So we've been working with Alacho and COSLA in terms of trying to deliver a pathway which gives effective adaptations at the time that they need it right at the outset. So COSLA and Alacho continue to work with MND and others in terms of that, about delivering that pathway. Happy to pick up with the member after this.
And Willie Rennie.
The Minister must know that 1 in 4 wheelchair users say their home is not suitable for their needs. There's 17,000 have unmet housing needs. So many in my constituency in North East Fife are desperate for a home, and they are desperate. Yet only 1% of the social housing is suitable. With 17 years of a social housing build programme, why are so many unsuitable for disabled people?
Minister.
I think it's very much a partnership approach. And I mentioned about the local housing strategies, which are obviously brought forward by the local authorities themselves. And discussions I've had with Fife and other local authorities, it's making sure that they're aware, first of all, the number of people who are in that position, as Mr Rennie talks about. But what can they do? And we've talked about the adaptation, the housing for varying needs, which talks about housing going forward. But it's really up to the local housing strategy, which Fife would have brought forward, to identify these number of houses doing that. I've raised it with Fife on a number of occasions, and again, happy to pick up Mr Rennie after this.
Thank you. Question 6 is not lodged. Question 7, Russell Finlay.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its plans to tackle social isolation and loneliness.
Minister Emma Roddick.
We published our delivery plan for our social isolation and loneliness strategy, Recovering Our Connections, in March 2023. The plan aims to better understand social isolation and loneliness, to reduce the harm caused by it and tackle this public health issue. The plan highlights the actions we are taking, including funding support of over £3 million to 53 organisations across Scotland over a 3-year period, delivering community-led activity that responds to local needs. The Scottish Government will continue to work with the Social Isolation and Loneliness Advisory Group to help us deliver this plan and collaborate on ways to tackle social isolation and loneliness for those most impacted.
Russell Finlay.
I thank the Minister for that answer. The Sunday Post and Age Scotland have launched the Big Bra Community, which is a campaign to reduce loneliness and isolation in older people by 2030. It's backed by the cartoon cavalcade legend Glenn Michael, who's 98 years old. Most people in here, perhaps apart from Megan, will know who I'm talking about. And today, using some good old-fashioned newspaper language, I can sensationally reveal that the campaign is now being backed by none other than Oor Willie, and that Scotland's naughtiest schoolboy is to break the habit of a lifetime by helping the old folk of Auchinshugel starting this Sunday. So get your Sunday Post. So does the Scottish Government join Glenn Michael, myself, Oor Willie, in supporting this excellent campaign?
Minister.
I'm not sure how old the member thinks I am, but while I don't understand all of his references, I certainly do understand the one to the Big Bra campaign, and we did discuss this at the most recent meeting of the Social Isolation and Loneliness Action Group. Very much welcome the support for the campaign to tackle social isolation and loneliness, and look forward to working with everybody involved to make sure that we're all on the same page and doing all that we can.
And David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Somebody who can remember Glenn Michael. Can the Minister elaborate on what impact the £3.2 million Social Isolation and Loneliness Fund is expected to have on the well-being of these groups and individuals across Scotland most in need of support?
Minister.
Happy to. I have managed to meet with quite a few of the organisations in receipt of the fund so far, and even on those very brief visits have been able to appreciate the impact that this is having on groups such as older people, younger people, those with mental health difficulties and disabled people. The fund's intention is of course to support organisations to create opportunities for people to connect, and we know that from evaluation of the first year of activity that many organisations have reported increased social connections and the associated improvement in mental well-being of participants. One organisation reported that 100% of participants have improved their confidence in going out and being socially active simply by engaging with the project. And the evaluation also told us that some organisations have improved partnership working in order to increase the activities on offer to communities. The total number of beneficiaries predicted to benefit from funded activities is around 20,000 over the duration of the fund, and we'll continue to monitor progress with the fund.
Thank you. And question 8, Jamie Green.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to comments by the Chartered Institute of Housing Scotland, which describes Scotland as being, quote, in the midst of a housing emergency.
Minister Paul McLennan.
Thank you, the member, for his question. I actually spoke to CIH at their conference last week on the day they announced that. We recognise the current housing challenges experienced across the UK and are determined to address levels of homelessness in part through the supply of social and affordable housing. However, the UK Government failed to improve inflation-proof their capital budget. This has resulted in a near 10% real terms cut in our capital funding. The financial attractions budget has also been cut by 62%. This is on top of Brexit and UK Government financial mismanagement causing inflationary pressures on construction supply and labour shortages. And as I mentioned previously, we're also working with the financial community in Scotland and elsewhere to boost private sector investment and deliver more homes.
Jamie Green.
I have to say, after 17 years in government, what a shameful response from the Minister. There are 10,000 children in Scotland in temporary accommodation. There are 130,000 households waiting for social housing, and that's the best we get from the front benches. Shelter accused this government, not any other government, of gaslighting the people of Scotland over the housing emergency. Three councils have declared a housing emergency, and this latest organisation is one of a long line to declare such an emergency. Everyone knows it's an emergency except this government. Can I ask the Minister, Shelter have specifically called on the First Minister to make an urgent statement to this Parliament about Scotland's housing emergency before the Easter recess? Can I ask, will he, and if he won't, why not?
Minister.
First of all, I can't comment for the First Minister, but I want to take up some of the points that you mentioned there. In terms of, if you look at the statement that Shelter also released about the UK Government, you will see it was as damning as the one to the Scottish Government. I think in terms of, if we're going to quote independent analysis, I think one of the key pieces of work that's come out in the last month or two was from Crisis, and it was a Homeson Monitor, which was independent from the from here at Warren University. The two main things that they mentioned having the biggest impact on reducing homelessness was the local housing allowance, which has been frozen by your government for a number of years. Yep. And there's a big demand on that. And that also goes to a challenge to the Labour Party as well. Once they come in, or if they come into power in the UK, then there's a chance for them to reinstate that as well. The second most important point they mentioned was the universal credit rates. And again, that's a decision being made by your government. And when it comes back to the 10% capital budget cut, if we're talking about decisions, that 10% capital budget cut was to pay for national insurance cuts for the most wealthy in society.
Yep. Thank you. A couple of supplementaries. First, Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister confirm that despite UK government capital funding cuts, Scotland's affordable housing supply programme remains the most ambitious and successful programme in the UK?
Minister.
Our affordable housing supply programme is indeed the most ambitious programme in the UK, and we remain focused on delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, despite the unprecedented UK government capital funding cuts. And since 2007, Scotland has led the way in housing, having delivered over 40% more affordable homes per head of population than England and 70% more than in Wales. From 23rd of March 22 to end of September 23, 15,765 homes have been delivered towards the 110,000 affordable homes target, of which 12,188 are homes for social rent.
And John Swinney.
President Officer, does the Minister accept that in the period since this government came to office in 2007, on average, more social housing properties have been constructed each year by this government than was the position for the 8 years before this government came to office? And while all of us want to see more affordable housing developments undertaken, wouldn't it help if the Scottish Government budget wasn't subjected to the callous cuts in capital expenditure that we've experienced from the Conservative government perpetually and consistently to enable this government to fulfil its objectives and to address the legitimate concerns that are raised by the housing sector?
Minister.
Can I thank the member for his question? Yeah, no, I would concur with the points that he's made, that the Scottish Government has consistently delivered more homes per head of population than any other parts of the UK. In terms of the budget cuts I mentioned about the impact that's had, the 10% capital budget cut, the 62% cut in financial transactions has made this thing extremely difficult for ourselves in terms of that. And I think it does come back to the point, if we're talking about decision-making and where we go in regards to this, the 10% capital budget cut paid for national insurance cuts for the most wealthy in society.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions. There will be a brief pause before we move to the next item of business to allow front benches to change.